Welcome. I'm John, a member here at Ebenezer, and on behalf of Ebenezer, we are so glad that you've decided to join us here online for church. I hope you're warm, but also ready to lift your eyes to our great God as we gather together. We've been considering over the past number of weeks ethics, and this morning we'll be considering relationships. We'll be delving in and dealing with difficult things, broken things. And you yourself, you may be feeling the disconnect of seeing people face to face, not being able to have that. Maybe you're feeling less loved than when there was face to face contact, not having that physical touch. And we look around at the moment, don't we? And so many things are not stable. Not many things are long lasting. But this morning we come to look at God, and we can know that His love endures forever. No matter what is happening, no matter what your week, His love endures forever. So if you have a Bible, read with me from Psalm 136. Psalm 136, and we'll begin from verse 1. Psalm 136, verse 1. Give thanks to the Lord, for He is good. His steadfast love endures forever. Give thanks to the God of gods, for His steadfast love endures forever. Give thanks to the Lord of lords, for His steadfast love endures forever. To Him who alone does great wonders, for His steadfast love endures forever. To Him who by understanding made the heavens, for His steadfast love endures forever. To Him who spread out the earth above the waters, for His steadfast love endures forever. To Him who made the great lights, for His steadfast love endures forever. The sun to rule over the day, for His steadfast love endures forever. The moon and stars to rule over the night, for His steadfast love endures forever. Coming down to verse 23. It is He who remembered us in our low estate, for His steadfast love endures forever. And rescued us from our foes, for His steadfast love endures forever. He who gives food to all flesh, for His steadfast love endures forever. Give thanks to the God of heaven, for His steadfast love endures forever. Let's pray together. Father God, we thank You that Your steadfast love endures forever. You see that we come from weeks and a world which feels like it's quite shaky. We know brokenness in relationships, in situations, in health. But Your steadfast love endures forever. Father, we thank You that You are the God of gods, that You are so much more powerful than anything else in this world, any ruler, and You alone do great wonders. We thank You that when we look at creation, we look at the sun, we look at everything around us, we can see a God who is glorious, a God who has given us a creation to enjoy because Your love endures forever. We thank You that despite the fact that we have rebelled against You in the past and even in this week, whether it be in choosing to not come to You, choosing to not cry out to You, choosing to not trust You, we are sorry. But we thank You so much that You have remembered us in our low estate. You have remembered us in our sin. And in Jesus, You have given us a way to know You because Your love endures forever. We thank You so much that You have given us all that we need, and that as we gather this morning, You can and will work through Your word to transform us, to show us Your love, and to help us think about what it looks like to stand as lights in Your world. So prepare our hearts, we pray, and lift our eyes to You. And may we sing of Your incredible love. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to sing a new song now, considering those truths that we've just read. Magnificent, marvelous, matchless love.
Thank you. His love, too vast and astounding to tell. Forever existing in worlds above, now offered and given to all. Oh, fountain of beauty eternal, the Father, the Spirit, the Son, sufficient and endlessly generous, magnificent, marvelous, matchless. Creation is brimming with thankfulness. The mountains exultant they stand. The seasons rejoice in your faithfulness. All life is sustained by your hand. You crown every meadow with color. You paint every shade in the sky. Each day the dawn wakes as an magnificent, marvelous, matchless love. Marvelous, matchless love. How great, how sure His love endures forevermore. Magnificent, marvelous, matchless love. How great, how sure His love endures.
Oh, hi church, I'm just going to mention a few announcements with you today. So session is meeting at 7 p.m. tomorrow night via Zoom. This means that all annual reports are due. Please email these annual reports to Keith Mitchell as soon as you can. Although many of our groups stopped meeting in March, we still need reports sent to him. We also are going to pray later on for our brothers and sisters at Castlemaine Presbyterian Church. They're making a big decision this afternoon about some of their church buildings and assets. So we'll pray for them. Also pray later on and keep in mind Amy Ezzy. She was one of our attendees at Cafe Church when we were meeting together. She moved from Northern Territory to Victoria earlier this year, or last year. But she's decided to head back to Northern Territory to be with her family this week. So please be praying for her as she returns home. And another announcement for all of our women and ladies out there. We're going to be running a women's event online in a few Saturdays' time. Saturday, September 5th, in the morning, just for an hour on Zoom. We just want to get together. We want to chat. We want to catch up. All ladies are welcome. Mayor's Angel will encourage us from God's word. So event will go up on Facebook this afternoon, and you can register your details online, and we're really excited to meet together with you. So that's all for today, and we're just going to have the Bible reading from Hannah and Sam.
Today's Bible reading is from Genesis chapter 1, verses 26 and 27. I'll be reading from the ESV. Then God said, "Let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the heavens, and over the livestock, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth." So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. Our second Bible reading is also from Genesis, chapter 2, verse 18 to the end of the chapter. Then the Lord God said, "It is not good for the man that the man should be alone. I will make him a helper fit for him." Now out of the ground the Lord God had formed every beast of the field and every bird of the heavens and brought them to the man to see what he would call them. And whatever the man called every living creature, that was its name. The man gave names to all the livestock and to the birds of the heavens and to every beast of the field. But for Adam there was not found a helper to fit for him. So the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon the man, and while he slept, took one of his ribs and closed up its place with flesh. And the rib that the Lord God had taken from the man, he made into a woman and brought her to the man. And the man said, "This at last is bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, because she was taken out of man. Therefore a man shall leave his father and mother and hold fast to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. And the man and his wife were both naked and were not ashamed."
Our third reading for today is from Ephesians chapter 5, verses 21 to chapter 6, verse 4. Submitting to one another out of reverence for Christ. Wives, submit to your own husbands as to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church, his body and is himself its saviour. Now as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit in everything to their husbands. Husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her, that he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of water with the word, so that he might present the church to himself in splendor, without spot or wrinkle, or any such thing, that such might be holy and without blemish. In the same way, husbands should love their wives as their own bodies. Who loves his wife loves himself. For no one ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes and cherishes it, just as Christ does the church, because we are members of his body. Therefore, a man shall leave his father and mother and hold fast to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. This mystery is profound, and I am saying that it refers to Christ and the church. However, let each one of you love his wife as himself, and let the wife see that she respects her husband. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother. This is the first commandment with a promise, that it may go well with you and that you may live long in the land. Fathers, do not provoke your children to anger, but bring them up in the discipline and instruction of the Lord. May the Lord add his blessing to this reading.
Thank you so much, Sam and Hannah. Good morning, everyone. You may not recognize me. Amy, before she went to Northern Territory, she gave me a bit of my annual shear, so that's a good thing. All ready for spring. We're talking about healthy relationships, and parents, obviously a PG rating on this talk as well. Part of talking about healthy relationships is also talking about domestic violence or what I'll call domestic abuse. So there'll be some times in the talk where it might be a bit frank, but that is what it is. So let's pray. Let's ask for God's help. Father God, we do thank you so much for your word. We thank you that you've created us for images, as in your image, for relationships. Help us all as we come to your word, and help me to preach according to your word. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So today we're talking about healthy relationships. Now, relationships are the key in life. We all need relationships. It doesn't matter what age or stage, relationships are vital. Because you could have the best of everything, but without someone to share it with, well, life's pretty empty. Now, we have to be honest, don't we? Relationships are challenging. We've got our family relationships, the immediate or the extended. We've got friends, either our close or distant friends. We've got our work colleagues or our school mates. We've got those who are in relationships with a sports club or a hobby, community group, or even our neighbours across the fence. And then there's church relationships, which is another dynamic as well. Now, all relationships, they need to be cultivated and invested into. You agree, wouldn't you? Relationships, they don't just happen. It takes time and effort, a building up of shared experiences, a working through differences and disagreements when they occur, and they normally do. And relationships too, they're so fragile, aren't they? One unthoughtful phrase or one heated outburst can damage a relationship instantly. Now, we've all experienced relationships that have broken down. At times when we have hurt or been hurt by others. At times when there's been misunderstanding, something's been said but been misinterpreted. Or those times when circumstances have just changed and you don't see each other for whatever reason. Now, we're looking at healthy relationships, and so we're going to look at the Bible and what God has created and planned, but then also look at how sin has entered the world, and a broken world with broken relationships. And a focus, of course, will be on unhealthy relationships, which can be harmful and even abusive. So let's do what we keep doing in this series. Let's go back to the beginning, back at Genesis 1. Genesis 1, God created everything out of nothing, and the pinnacle of his creation was humanity. God created humans in his image. And a couple of weeks ago, we looked at what that meant, that God created male and female in his image, and as we discussed, that they are equal. Both male and female were to rule the earth under God's authority. And last week we looked at Genesis 2, and we had that as our Bible reading this morning. And God created Adam and Eve. He created Adam out of the dust and Eve out of Adam's rib. Adam and Eve are of the same substance, but distinct. Distinct, but equal. At the end of Genesis 2, there's perfect harmony in the relationships between Adam and Eve and between them and God. But Genesis 3, there is rebellion. Sin arrives and the result is broken relationships. You would be familiar with Genesis 3. Satan, who has broken relationship with God, he enters Eden as a snake, the Garden of Eden as a snake. And he tempts Eve to do the only thing God commanded Adam and Eve not to do. Satan tempts Eve to eat the fruit of the tree of knowledge of good and evil. Now, it's really important to understand that Adam is right there present with Eve while Satan is tempting her. Now, Eve, of course, should have said, "No thanks, I'm going to trust God and his word over yours." Adam should have said, "Get away from us, Satan," or perhaps, "No, Eve." But they both got sucked in. They both doubted God. They both allowed themselves to follow Satan's temptation. And so Adam and Eve are both guilty. Sure, Eve has a more active role, but Adam is still just as responsible as Eve. And as a result of their rebellion, there is broken relationships with them and God and each other. They realize that they're naked and they cover up. They hear God walking in the garden and they hide. And then the blame game starts. God asks Adam if he's eaten the tree that he told him not to. And what does Adam say? The woman that you gave me, she gave me the fruit and I ate. You see what he's doing? It's all her fault, not his fault. And then God asks Eve, what have you done? And Eve replied, the serpent deceived me and I ate. You see, don't you? Adam blames Eve, Eve blames Satan. Broken relationships. But also there's the reverse order of the creation order. Instead of God, man, woman, animal, it's animal, woman, man, God. And so God brings down two curses and two punishments for their actions. The two curses are on the snake and on the ground. And the two punishments are on Adam and Eve. And one of the punishments is a broken relationship between Adam and Eve. Genesis 3 and verse 16, the second half of that verse, he's God speaking to Eve. Your desire shall be contrary to your husband, but he shall rule over you. Again, people often misunderstand this statement. It's talking about the struggle in marriage. Instead of living perfectly content and at peace, the husband and wife are now going to struggle for power and control. Eve's going to want Adam to conform to her way, and Adam's going to want Eve to conform to his way. And as we know, there's tension, isn't there, between Adam and Eve instead of harmony. And they get kicked out of the Garden of Eden, and it's hard and toilsome. They no longer can have access to the tree of life, so aging and death is a reality. The punishment of sin is death. A work has become a curse and a burden rather than blessing and joy. We're going to look at that next week. And childbirth became painful and raising children challenging. And we all know the pain and toil of life outside the garden. Now, before we go on blaming Adam and Eve for all the brokenness in the world, let's take a moment just to think about it. We too would do the same if we were Adam or Eve. We would make the same mistake because it's our natural selfishness. And you can just think about this, can't you? Think about the most beautiful paradise location you've ever been to. You know, think about that tropical island, that majestic mountaintop. Think about Ballarat in July. Oh, what a blessing. Wherever it is, right? You're at that ideal, pristine, perfect paradise, but so quickly, as soon as you turn up with your family, paradise is lost to grumpy, selfish people. You've experienced it, yeah? It's a sad reality of life. We have broken relationships wherever we look. We need someone to heal us, to heal our brokenness. And that's why Jesus comes into the world. Jesus came into the broken world to restore it. He took on the selfishness and brokenness. When he died on the cross, he paid the rebellion. He paid for our rebellion and sin. Jesus was broken on the cross to heal our brokenness. Most importantly, Jesus was broken so that our broken relationship with God could be healed. That's the gospel. Jesus' brokenness so that we could be restored as God's children. When we trust in Jesus as our Lord and Savior, as Kristen said with the kids, Jesus is also our Savior, who we depend on our forgiveness, but he's also our boss, he's our Lord, the one we submit to. And as Christians, we serve one another as Jesus served us, which brings us to our Bible reading in Ephesians. Now, Ephesians, like most of Paul's letters, can be divided into two sections. The first half addresses all that God has done for the Ephesians. God sent Jesus, through Jesus they're saved. God gave his Holy Spirit, all the blessings of being Christians. That's the first half. And the second half is how the Ephesians are to live in response. How Christians are to live in response to all that God has given. Now this passage, as you might have heard Hannah read, has one of those really ugly words that our society doesn't tolerate. Now before you go for the remote, just give me a chance, okay? Now I've married a number of people. Well, I'm married to Michelle McIntosh, the best, but I have, as a pastor, married a number of people. And all the couples that I've done premarital counselling, there's a couple of Bible passages, and one of them is this. Now, I've done a few outside the church, and it's always the same scenario for non-Christians. When the female reads the word submission, she says, as if. And I just ask, I just wait to the end and then decide. And every time at the end of the discussion, the female said, well, yeah, I could do that. That's easy compared to what he has to do. So I just ask everyone, just wait till the end before you get too angry or upset. The first obvious point, as we look at the passage that Hannah read, there's a section for wives and a section for husbands. But the instructions for the husbands is three times longer than the instructions for the wives. So let's start with the big section for husbands. Verse 25. Husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her, that he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of water with the word, so that he might present the church to himself in splendor, without spot or wrinkle or any such thing, that she might be holy and without blemish. Husbands, we are to love our wives sacrificially as Christ did the church. That means we as husbands are to sacrifice our wants and desires for our wives. It doesn't mean we literally die, although if the situation were to arise, you'd hope that most husbands would put themselves in harm's risk to protect their wives. Jesus gave up his life for his bride, the church. Jesus died on the cross so that we could be saved. Husbands, we are to sacrifice ourselves and our desires for our wives. Now, the little things. Friday night, sacrifice the footy. Watch that romantic film, no matter how garbage it is. But also the big things. Let's think about careers where, for blokes, we get our identity so much. Consider what career or what working hours is best for your wife and family, not just for yourself or what your boss thinks. I know husbands that have taken long service leave or leave without pay to look after their children so that their wives could return to work for a period. Husbands, we need to sacrifice our wants and preferences for hers. So a good question to ask us husbands. What have you given up for your wife today, this week? How have you and I proven my love by sacrificing what I want for what she needs or wants? See, this is the difference with Christian leadership. Christian leadership is servant leadership. Jesus, our boss, wiped the stinky feet of his disciples. Jesus, our King of Kings, died on his cross, which was his throne. As leaders of our family and of our marriages, we need to be servant leaders. And you probably notice that we started in verse 21, not verse 22. Verse 21, submitting to one another out of reverence for Christ. Wives, submit to your own husbands as to the Lord, for the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church, his body, and he is himself its Saviour. Now, as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit in everything to their husbands. So verse 21, every one of us, every Christian is to submit to our Lord and Saviour Jesus. In order to be a Christian, we have to submit to Jesus. But also, Christians, we are to serve one another. As Christians, we place not our needs, but the needs of our brothers and sisters before our own. We submit to one another as we're Christians. And so Paul says, having said that, he writes to the Christian married women, wives, submit to your husbands as to the Lord. Jesus is the head of the church, husbands are the head of the marriage. But remember, their leadership is servant, sacrificial leadership. What happens if a wife and a husband fight to be head? Well, there's friction, there's constant battle, isn't there? What happens if the wife leads? Well, often the husband just sits back, disengages, sits on the couch, watches the telly, doesn't put in. You've probably seen it. The more the wife does, the more and more she does, the husband just checks out. He's present, but he's disengaged. He's lazy. He won't make any sacrifice. He just keeps his head down and keeps going. Ladies, if you want your man to help out more, then ask him to lead. A nagging doesn't, you know, it doesn't really help anyone, does it? They say, hey, I need you to lead. And that will really get him going. See, one of the differences between men and women is that men, we need to prove our worth. We need to know that we're making a difference, that your life is better because of us. And that our wives respect us and admire us and our work. Whereas for women, and, you know, text me, tell me if I'm wrong, women need to be shown that they're of worth, that they're worth protecting and serving. And women really need to know that they are secure, that they are loved and cherished above everything else by God, that their husbands love and care for them and their work. That their husbands love them more than anyone else. And here's the thing, right? If the husband is serving, as we have in our passage, then he's placing the needs of his wife before his own. The decisions he makes are for his wife's best interests in the family. And if the wife is serving, as the passage says, she will trust and allow her husband to lead and make decisions. Now, obviously, it doesn't mean every decision. It's more about the big stuff. But what happens when things aren't healthy? Well, let's talk about domestic abuse. What is domestic abuse? Well, the Sydney Anglican Safe Church Unit equivalent, they have a really helpful definition, because we often just think of physical. Domestic abuse includes, but is not limited to, emotional, verbal, social, economic, psychological, spiritual, physical, and sexual abuse. Such behavior often seeks to control, humiliate, dominate, or instill fear in the victim. Now, how much does domestic abuse occur in Australia? Jess Hill, in her Stella Prize book, See What You Made Me Do, states that 1 in 4 Australian women have experienced domestic abuse. 1 in 4. And often we think, as I said before, we just think of physical abuse, But Hill states that for many victims, physical violence is actually what hurts the least. And most often, domestic abuse is not a crime as such, but is so horribly wrong. Hill explains, for example, it is not a crime to demand your partner no longer see her family or friends. It's not a crime to convince your wife that she's worthless. It's not a crime to lie so many times that you break her sense of what is real. Now, it's important to note that no two cases of domestic abuse are the same. There are common methods of control, is what is referred to coercive control. A coercive control is the act or pattern of acts, assault, threats, humiliation, and intimidation or other abuse that is used to harm, punish, or frighten their victim. Now, in Great Britain, a coercive control is, in an intimate relationship, is now classified as criminal. And in Australia, states such as Queensland have begun to consider if coercive control in an intimate relationship should be classified as a crime here too. Why? It's because the dangers of coercive control to women and children and the long-term negative impacts upon victims of coercive control. Now, what's also really hard is that most domestic abuse occurs in relationships designed and intended by God to be a loving relationship where forgiveness is meant to be practiced. Added to this, the Christian understanding that divorce is wrong unless there is clear biblical grounds as articulated in the New Testament. This means that for some Christian wives suffering domestic abuse, they have the wrong impression that divorce is not an option for them. Now, let me be really clear. Domestic abuse in any form is not to be tolerated. A Christian wife who is suffering domestic abuse does not and should not have to tolerate this treatment by her husband. Never. And we as a church, we need to make sure that everybody is safe. So one of the areas that needs to be addressed is the non-biblical leadership. It's called hyperheadship. It's when husbands treat their wife as a child and attempt to control them. Now, hyperheadship occurs in all aspects of society, including the church. And in our church, where we hold to a complementarian leadership or headship, there is a danger that church-going husbands can twist scripture to suit their selfish desires. Now, the Presbyterian Church of Victoria has approved and endorsed a statement on domestic family violence. I can give you that document. You can get on the web. We can send you the link. But let me just read you one of the paragraphs. This is really important for us to understand. Therefore, any attempt to twist the biblical teaching of male servant leadership and a wife's voluntary submission to tactilely sanction domestic violence or abuse is a gross perversion. Nowhere in Scripture is a husband told to force his wife to submit, and more than a wife is told to conjure her husband to lead. Domestic and family violence is repugnant to God, nowhere condoned in Scripture, and an anathema to the biblical model of sacrificial love and service. Very clear. It's a no-go zone. Now, Jason Meyer, pastor of Bethlehem Baptist Church in the US, he's really helpful. I've got a couple of quotes from him. Now, Meyer states, "Hyperheadship is a satanic distortion of male leadership, but it can fly under the radar of discernment because it is disguised as strong male leadership. Make no mistake, it is harsh, oppressive, and controlling. In other words, hyperheadship becomes a breeding ground for domestic abuse." Now, for us as a church, this is a really important thing we have to be aware of that I think a lot of us just aren't aware of. Meyer says that when there is a situation where it appears to be a couple in this situation of abuse, there is no neutral zone. Now, an unhealthy relationship is really hard to deal with. No one wants to get involved. You know, the natural temptation when we hear about a couple is just to remove ourselves, to not get involved. Amaya states there is no neutral ground because he says there's three options, yeah? We can side with the perpetrator, we can take no side, and we can side with the victim and stand up to the perpetrator. But here's what the thing that we need to know. To say and do nothing, to take no side, is actually passively approving the perpetrator. To say and do nothing is disempowering the victim. So if there is a situation of a couple being separated because of domestic abuse, the victim is a priority. The victim needs to be supported and empowered. We as a church need to take care in what we say and how we say it, because we don't know all the facts. For example, you could be really heartbroken that a couple is separated, yeah? And your honest desire more than anything is for that couple to get back together. Now, here's the thing. If you say to the victim, "I'm praying that you'll get back together," what are you doing? You're passively putting pressure on the victim. The expectation is she needs to be a good little girl and go back to that abusive partner. And that's wrong. I get your desire that there would be no divorce. I get that you want people to stay together. But a more helpful and empowering word of encouragement to that victim is, "I'm praying that God would change your partner's heart. I'm praying for your protection and support." You see the difference? You're wanting them to get back together, but you're actually empowering rather than burdening the victim. So what do we do as a church? Well, if you see something that's not right or something that you're uncomfortable about, well, speak. Just ask the person if they're okay. I know it's hard, I know it's awkward, I know it's horrible, yeah? Even if that question shuts the conversation down, better to have said something to bring it out in the open and have that moment of awkwardness than to ignore it and passively side with the perpetrator. A simple question: is everything okay? Is everything okay between you two? It may be the very question that will actually help someone to realize, hang on a minute, why are they asking if everything's okay? I thought it was just me. The fact that my Christian friend is asking me if it's okay, maybe there's something that's not. Boys and girls, if you're still there, can I speak to you? If you hear or see something that makes you uncomfortable, speak up. Boys and girls, it's not your fault. You are not to blame. Your parents need to know that you're uncomfortable. Sometimes arguments get a bit too loud, and it's best that they stop if that's what happened. Kids, speak to an adult that you trust if things aren't right. Now, you might think that if you tell someone, you might make things worse. It won't. Telling someone may be the only thing that stops it. As a church, we need to act and not gossip. If you see something wrong, will you talk to me as the pastor? Or even better, talk to Safe Church directly. Fiona Bly, she is a wonderful Christian woman and she is so experienced and so helpful. She always has her mobile with her. You can call her at any time and report. There's her mobile number. Fiona, she's dealt with some severe situations. She has experience, but she's also happy to talk even if there's nothing there. Better to be safe and checked than not. So there's her mobile phone. You can also look up the Safe Church unit on the website. But in Ballarat, of course, if things are really dire, Triple O is the one to call. But if you need help, or Berry Street, or RISC, you can Google that acronym. That's the support here in Ballarat. As a church, we need to remove the wrong and unhelpful attitudes. There is no excuse for unhealthy relationships. Domestic abuse is a complex situation, and no one deserves it. No one asks for it. As we said, relationships are key to life. In a broken world, there is going to be broken relationships. And we as Christians must try and maintain and restore and reconcile our relationships with each other. But as the Bible teaches again and again, God gets involved with the mess. God is our rock and our fortress. He is our good shepherd that will help us in all of life. But the other great thing with God is what is impossible with man is possible with God. God is here and he will help. If you or someone you know is dealing with an unhealthy relationship, we need to help. Now, after the service, you can call me on my mobile or my wife, Michelle McIntosh. She'll be on the church office. We've redirected that number to her mobile. If there's someone you need to talk with, someone you need to pray with, we want to help. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you that you are a God of relationships. We thank you that you are the one who created us in your image. But we thank you too that even though we broke relationship with you, we rebelled, we selfishly did our own thing, Father God, we thank you that you never give up on us, that you are always there, your grace always abounds. And we thank you so much, Father God, that with Jesus all things are possible. Father God, for those of us that are dealing with past hurts, Lord, help us to take them to you. For those of us who are unsure what's happening, help us to find out answers. And Father God, we pray for us as a church that you help us support one another, but also to be a lighthouse of healthy relationships. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Are we going to sing Imagine? And then after that, John's going to lead us in prayer. So I invite you can stretch the legs and sing as we sing together.
Dust and you breathe life into us in your image. We were made to live. You gave us the world even more. You gave us yourself in your likeness. We to undo the curse and he lived. this life again.
Pray together. Father God, we thank you for this reminder that we've just sung about, of Jesus. We thank you that in him we've been saved, we've been redeemed, we've been rescued. We thank you for his perfection, that he lived the perfect life to make this broken image right. We thank you that we have a broken relationship with you that's been restored because of Jesus. We thank you that you have made a way to know a close and intimate and enduring love in you. We thank you that in Jesus we also see this beautiful servant leadership, this man who was willing to wash others' feet, to give up his life on the cross. But we're sorry. We're sorry that the reality is in our relationships, there's so much selfishness. Whether it's apathy or selfish ambition or carelessness or desire for control, bitterness, we are selfish. We accept Jesus' love for us, but we neglect to reflect it to others. Please forgive us. We're also sorry as church that so often we don't work hard to pursue the safety of others. We oversimplify things and we don't do the hard work to understand complex situations by asking difficult and awkward questions. We're sorry that sometimes we are not the safe church that is loving and empowering healthy relationships. And we don't show Jesus' love to the world in the way that we should. But we thank you that for all of those struggling, for all of those struggling with broken relationships, you are a refuge and a strength. We thank you that you have provided your church. You've provided Fiona. You've provided a government which stands against domestic violence. And you've shown us an example in Jesus of what servant leadership and sacrificial looks like. So we pray that you would help us. Help us in our homes to show Jesus. Help us in our churches and our relationships to show his love. Help us support and stand for what is right. But we also lift up those at this time who are unwell. We think of Keith and Yvonne and Evan's brother with COVID. We think of Emma Wildman in her final stages of pregnancy. And we just pray that you would be with each of these situations. Help them have peace. Help them to cry out to you in their struggles. And we pray that you would be bringing healing, working through the health services around them, and that you be giving peace to their loved ones in this time. We pray for those battling with coronavirus and mourning the passing of loved ones, and others battling with other forms of diagnosis and struggles with ongoing health conditions that haven't been mentioned. Please be with them at this time. Please grant them strength and courage and hope. Help them to be able to keep their eyes fixed on eternity. We pray for our church. We pray for our elders and Toby and other leaders. We pray that you would grant them wisdom and grace and passion for your church and for the lost. We pray for the women's event in a fortnight. We pray that you would be going ahead of that. In the team planning and those attending, we ask that you would encourage and stir up your church to love and good deeds. We pray that you would be preparing hearts and opening doors for our upcoming evangelism course. We pray that you would help us to be bold and love our friends and those around us enough to pray for them and to invite them when the opportunity comes. We pray for Amy as she heads back to the Northern Territory this week. We pray that you would be with all of the things that need to happen. And we pray for Castlemaine and ask that you would be with their decision as they look to what they should be doing with their church buildings and the challenges that come as a result of that. But we look wider as well to our state, and we pray that you would be with Daniel Andrews and all of the healthcare workers and all of those involved in trying to help us to be able to control this outbreak and continue to support those who are struggling. We pray that you would be granting them wisdom. We pray for Scott Morrison and churches around this country. We pray that you would grant them wisdom and justice for those who are struggling, and most of all, a realization of the need to depend on you and trust in Jesus, not our science or our technology, but in you. We lift up this world to you, a world that is suffering in so many different ways. We pray for the Mihalis in Hungary and Basha in Bangladesh. We pray that you would be working through them to be able to bring great hope and support to those who need it, but also bring the greatest hope and support of the good news of Jesus. We pray for the persecuted church, that you would sustain them in all of the suffering that they're experiencing. Help them to not give up sharing the good news of Jesus, no matter what it costs. We pray that you would continue to send workers into the harvest and mobilize people from every nation to go to reach the lost for you. And we pray that in and through all of these different things, in our lives, in all of the things we've mentioned, you would be working to show this world how glorious you are, that you are the one and only King. You are the one and only King who is so infinitely worthy of our worship. Do that through these things, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's sing together.
Lift up your
Rejoice, the Lord is King, and he's coming back someday. Just a reminder, if you found today's message particularly confronting and you'd like to talk with someone, Michelle McIntosh is available on the church phone number, which is on your screen. Toby will also be available on his mobile. If you're joining tonight, please jump on the Zoom discussion and prayer afterwards as we continue to talk about this. And let's just close now with a passage from 1 Thessalonians chapter 2. May the Lord make you increase and abound in love for one another and for all, as we do for you, so that he may establish your hearts blameless in holiness before our God and Father at the coming of our Lord Jesus with all his saints. Hope to see you next week.